الحمد لله الذي معنا وياكم سبحانه وتعالى في هذا المسجد المبارك نتلقى الرحمات الإلهية والبركات الربانية.
Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for gathering us inside of this blessed mosque in which we embrace mercy and blessings from him subhanahu wa ta'ala.
هذه الرحمات التي يفتحها المولى سبحانه وتعالى لعباده مساء وصباحا.
It is mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens up for the slaves by night and by day.
لعباده المؤمنين ولعباده المكذبين.
For those people who believe in him subhanahu wa ta'ala, but likewise for those who deny him.
رحمة لهم سبحانه وتعالى.
Out of mercy for them.
رحمة للعباد المؤمنين الرحمة الكاملة في الدنيا والآخرة.
A perfection of mercy inside of this world as well as the next for those who are faith in him subhanahu wa ta'ala.
رحمة للعباد غير المسلمين حتى يحفظ ذواتهم في هذه الحياة ولا تسلط عليهم الأمراض ولا الآفات.
Mercy for those who disbelieve in him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just that they are protected and they are not afflicted by illness.
ذلك قال المولى سبحانه وتعالى في مطلع سورة فاطر ما يفتح الله للناس من رحمة فلا ممسك لها ولم يضل المسلمين ولا المؤمنين ما يفتح الله للناس من رحمة فلا ممسك لها.
The Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the beginning of Surah Al-Fatiha that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens up of mercy for people and none can withhold. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never do said for the believers when he said for people, for humanity.
لكن نحن المسلمون نتلقى هذه الرحمات الخاصة التي أشار إليها المولى سبحانه وتعالى بقوله يختص برحمته من يشاء.
But we as Muslims that we embrace elect mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alluded to in his statement that he delegates mercy for whomever he pleases.
وهذه الرحمات الخاصة من الله سبحانه وتعالى تشرح الصدور وتملأ البواطن بالنور.
And this elect mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it dilates hearts, and likewise it fills them with light.
وإذا امتلأت البواطن بالنور تمسك المسلم بحبائب الإسلام والإيمان.
And whenever the heart is filled now with light, that the human being now holds on tight to faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
كما قال المولى سبحانه وتعالى فمن شرح الله صدره للإسلام فهو على نور.
As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says that whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens up or dilates his heart to faith, then he is upon a light.
وهذا النور من المولى سبحانه وتعالى فهو على نور من ربه ونور الرب سبحانه وتعالى لا يخطي نور الرب سبحانه وتعالى يضيء الطريق لكل مسلم ومسلمة.
This is light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that upon light from their Lord and the light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala illuminates the path for every male as well as female believer.
وإذا أردت أن يزداد ذلك النور في قلبك أيها المؤمن فاقرأ سورة النور واكثر من ذكر الله تعالى والصلاة على نبيه محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم فيقوى هذا النور المعنوي في باطنك.
And if you want to increase any light then you should read the surah of light, the surah of nur inside of the Quran. That will strengthen your faith and also your attachment to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.
هذا النور الباطني الذي يقذفه الله في قلب العبد النور من المولى سبحانه وتعالى لا يشبه الأنوار التي نعرفها ليس كنور الشمس ولا كنور السرج ولا كنور النجوم نور من الله أتى ذكره في سورة النور فاستقري.
And this light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which is a metaphysical and a spiritual light, it does not resemble physical light like the light of the sun or the light of a lamp or the light of the stars, and this is a different type of light, so pay attention and take heed.
والنور قد يكون حسيا كما نشاهده ونلاحظه وقد يكون معنويا يهتدي به الإنسان إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى وإلى سعادته في هذه الحياة.
And light can be physical, but it can likewise be also metaphysical in that it will guide you unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
فإذا نحن نتلقى نصيبنا من رحمات الله سبحانه وتعالى التي في طيها هذه الأنوار المعنوية.
And so thereby we now embrace the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enveloped within is this light that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وقد كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في كل ليلة إذا أمسى يقول اللهم من يسلوك خير هذه الليلة فتحها ونصرها ونورها وبركتها وهداها فيطلب من الله عز وجل نور الليلة ونور اليوم الذي يرسله الله عز وجل للقلوب وللعقول.
And so thereby we seek this light that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama which would ask for each and every single day. Oh Allah, I ask you for the good of this day as well as its opening, as well as its light. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallama said of the day and likewise of the night sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
والنور للصدور هذا يشرحها ويفرحها فيكون المسلم فرحا مسرورا بعطاء الله سبحانه وتعالى وبفضل الله عز وجل.
And the light when it enters inside of your heart, you're thereby يعني happy and ecstatic over the gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows upon you.
كما أمرنا ربنا سبحانه وتعالى بذلك في قوله قل بفضل الله وبرحمته فبذلك فليفرحوا نفرح بفضل الله وبرحمته علينا سبحانه وتعالى.
As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, say يعني by virtue of the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His mercy, in that let people rejoice.
والنور في العقول هذا يجعل تفكير العقول تفكيرا صحيحا تفكيرا نافعا لصاحبه يثمر له السعادة في الدنيا والآخرة.
Any light of the intellect, it allows the one who possesses يعني such to have proper contemplation and reflection and thought, that which leads to happiness eternally inside of the world to come.
وانظروا إلى العقول المنقطعة عن نور القرآن وعن نور تعليمات النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. كيف تبكي هذه العقول؟ كما قال الله تعالى في سورة الملك وقالوا لو كنا نسمع أو نعقل ما كنا في أصحاب السعير. يبكون على هذه العقول التي لم تنفعهم ولم ترشدهم إلى السعادة الحقيقية.
يعني look at the types of intellects that are severed from the light of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. They will cry out of remorse, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Al-Mulk, the chapter of the dominion side of the Quran. They will say, had we only listened attentively, negating mind as well as using our mind, we would not be from the inhabitants of the burning inferno. And so such people now, they've cut themselves off from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by not allowing their intellect to be illumined by that light.
وأنت أيها المسلم كلما ازددت فرحا بفضل الله عليك وبرحمته ازددت شرحا للصدر وازددت نورا من الله سبحانه وتعالى. أنت أيها المسلم كلما فرحت بفضل الله عليك ورحمته.
And so you are Muslim, the more you now are happy with the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you will increase in light from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وإذا شرح صدرك بهذا النور فهمت عظمة هذا الدين وسر هذا الدين ولب هذا الدين.
And if this light now dilates and opens up your heart, the more you'll understand about the greatness and the exaltation and the beauty of this religion.
وفضل الله سبحانه وتعالى علينا وعليك شرح صدورنا للإيمان واجعلنا المسلمين المؤمنين.
And the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon each and every single one of us dictates that our hearts open up to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala so that we become believers in Him.
وهذه الهداية للإيمان والإسلام ليست بالوراثة وليست بالعلم وليست بالاجتهاد إنما هي بالرحمة من الله سبحانه وتعالى.
And guidance unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not by your knowledge that you possess, it's not something that you inherit, nor is about your endeavor and your toil and struggle, but this is mercy bestowed from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وإذا شكرنا ربنا سبحانه وتعالى على نعمة الإسلام والإيمان عرفنا أنها مرحلة مؤقتة علامة لما قبلها ودلالة على ما يأتي بعدها.
And whenever we show gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessing of Islam and Iman, it is merely a sign for what has came before, and it's an indication for that which is yet to come.
إذا رأيت نفسك في هذه الحياة المؤقتة تشهد لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله، فعلم أن هذا إذا مت عليه علامة على ما تقدم من الأزل، على ما كتب في القضاء والقدر أنك مسلم مؤمن، فظهر مراد الله عز وجل فيك عندما جئت إلى هذه الحياة.
If you bear witness and testify there is no deity but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you thereby die upon that, that is a sign for that which came before in pre-eternality with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed for you to be a Muslim and to have faith in Him subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وكذلك إذا ثبتت على هذا الدين عرفت أنه مقدمة للحياة الأبدية العظيمة التي لا تنتهي. سمعنا الإمام قرأ عنها قوله سبحانه وتعالى وسيق الذين اتقوا ربهم إلى الجنة زمرا حتى إذا جاءوها فتحت أبوابها.
And so likewise also, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala affirms you upon this faith such that you die upon it, likewise it's indicative of what is yet to come from this eternal life of eternal happiness. As we heard the recital of the Quran say in Surah Al-Zumar, they are driven, وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ تَقَوْ رَبَّهُمْ, those who have consciousness of their Lord are driven to paradise in multitudes, such that the doors of paradise are flung open for them.
وانظر إلى تعبير الحق سبحانه وتعالى وسيق الذين اتقوا ربهم إلى الجنة زمرا جماعات جماعات إشارة إلى المسلمين يعيشون جماعات جماعات. فأنت إذا انضممت إلى جماعة المسلمين من أقاربك ومن معلميك فستدخل معهم الجنة زمرا.
And so we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says those who are truly conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are driven to paradise in crowds, i.e. multitudes after multitudes, groups after groups. If you now are attached to Muslims in terms of your families and your extended families and your friends inside of this world, that is indicative likewise that inside the next world, you will enter paradise alongside them in crowds and groups and
families. كان موجودا في علم الله ثم ظهر بعد ذلك في اللوح المحفوظ.
And you should know likewise also that your faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not begin when you perceived that your faith began, but rather your faith is pre-eternal. The knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed for you and thereafter it manifested in the well-guarded tablet, the lawh al-mahfuz.
وهذا الذي يسمى عندنا القضاء والقدر الذي يجب على كل مسلم أن يؤمن به وأن يصدقه فأوامر الله ليست من الآن ومظاهر قدرته سبحانه وتعالى ليست من الآن كل شيء قد كتب ولا يتغير.
And what we're referring to here is what is known as al-qadar wal-qada, which is the decree and the enactment of that decree. That everything that occurs is in accordance with that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already preordained inside of pre-eternality.
يَمْحُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيُثْبِتُ وَعِنْدَهُ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then as he says, he erases that which he pleases and affirms, and the matrix of the book is with him.
الْمَحْوِ يعني شيء كان موجوداً فيمحو ويثبت شيء موجود يثبته يمحو ويثبت لكن الذي أم الكتاب لا يمحو ولا يثبت مكتوب الذي فيه أم الكتاب.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he erases from existence that which had prior existence. And that which had prior existence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likewise affirms in existence subhanahu wa ta'ala, but with him, nothing is changing.
فَإِذَنْ إِيمَانُنَا وَطَاعَاتُنَا وَأَعْمَالُنَا كُلُّهَا مَكْتُوبَ كُلُّهَا بِقَدَرْ كَمَا قَالَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى إِنَّا كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقْنَاهُ بِقَدَرْ.
Then our faith and our obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of it has been predetermined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, everything we have created has been predetermined, foreordained.
ولذلك النبي المصطفى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم عندما علم في حديث جبريل أركان الإيمان سيدنا جبريل أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله فلما وصل إلى الإيمان بالقضاء والقدر أكده بالفعل وتؤمن بالقضاء والقدر أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله وتؤمن قال ولم يقل صلى الله عليه وسلم بالقضاء والقدر وتؤمن بالقضاء والقدر تأكيدا على أهميته في حياة الإنسان فأنه يرث الطمأنينة والأمان والإقبال على الله إذا اطمأن أن كل شيء بالقضاء والقدر.
And that's why with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in the hadith of Gabriel, the hadith of Jibril عليه السلام, when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم enumerated the articles of faith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that it's that you believe in Allah and his angels and his books and his prophets and his last day. But he did not say and in the decree. He said and you believe. He's saying and you believe, repeating the word to believe in order to emphasize belief in decree for ordainment and enactment of that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has predetermined, such that now it bequeaths inside of your heart any serenity and contentment in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such that you approach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accordingly.
وَتُؤْمِنْ بِالْقَضَى وَالْقَدَرِ خَيْرِهِ وَشَرِّهِ مِنَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى خَيْرُهُ وَشَرُّهُ بِالنِّسْبَةِ لَكَ أَيُّهَا الْمُسْلِمُ أَمَّا بِالنِّسْبَةِ لِلْحَقِّ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ فَلَا يُسَمَّى شَرٌّ بِالنِّسْبَةِ لِلْحَقِّ وَلَا خَيْرٌ اللَّهُ خَالِقُ الْخَيْرِ وَخَالِقُ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى وَلَكِنَّهُ شَرٌّ بِالنِّسْبَةِ إِلَيْهِ أَمَّا هُوَ الْخَالِقُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى.
Yani, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that you believe in the decree, both the good as well as the evil of it, sallallahu wasallam. However, when we speak about good and evil is from your perspective. It's not from the perspective of the divine subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of good, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of evil. But everything Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does from his perspective is nothing but good, Jalla Jalala Ta'ala.
وَلَا يُوجَدْ شَرٌ لِلْمُسْلِمِ مِنْ جَمِيعِ الْوُجُوهُ بِجَمِيعِ الْمَعَانِي فِي الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ أَبَدًا إِلَّا شَيْءٌ وَاحِدٌ فَقَطْ كُلَّ شَرْ أَنْتَ تَظُنُّهُ شَرْ هُوَ قَدْ يَكُونُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ وَقَدْ يَكُونُ خَيْرٌ لِغَيْرِكَ أَيْضًا الْمَرَضُ وَالْفَقْرُ وَالِابْتِلَاءُ كُلَّمَا أَصَابَكَ أَنْتَ تَظُنُّهُ شَرٌ فِي حَقِّكَ وَهُوَ لَيْسَ كَذَلِكَ حَتَّى وَإِنْ كَانَ فِي هَذِهِ الْحَالَةِ شَرٌّ فِي حَقِّكَ فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ.
There is no such thing as absolute evil, yani whether it be in this world or inside of the world to come, except with one notable exception. Anything that you believe to be evil, there's also a perspective from which you could gaze upon it, which is good, regardless of whether we're speaking about poverty or we're speaking about tribulations or we're speaking about sickness. That from one perspective, they can be evil, but from another perspective, they can be good.
حتى الكفر قد يكون فيه خير، لأن الإنسان قد يكون في بداية أمره كافرا ثم يدخل الإسلام فيقوى إيمانه ويتندم على تلك الفترة التي عاشها فيزداد من الأعمال الصالحة فتكون خيرا له.
Even kufr, disbelief, and if there can be a perspective of good upon which we can understand disbelief as an example, somebody is a disbeliever, but thereby they're guided to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they enter into the fold of Islam and they become affirmed inside of the religion. But then they look back upon their days of disbelief and then thereby remorse now fills their heart such that it only stirs them to increase in good being a Muslim.
الشر الوحيد الذي ليس فيه خير للإنسان والعياذ بالله من أي وجه أن يكون بعيدا عن الله في الدار الآخرة معذبا في جهنم هذا ليس فيه أي خير لا من هذا الوجه ولا من هذا الوجه.
An exception in this regard is when somebody is distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inside of the world to come, so that they're cast inside of the midst of hellfire to be eternally punished therein. This is absolute evil now, unrestricted.
ولذلك تؤمن أيها المسلم بالقضاء وهو سبق الكائنات في علم الله سبحانه وتعالى أي وجود الكائنات وما يصدر منها من حيوان أو إنسان وغير ذلك وتصرفات موجودة في علم الله ثم كتب ذلك في اللوح المحفوظ.
And when we speak about the decree, decree means the pre or the prior existence of creation in terms of entities as well as in terms of acts in the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inscribes it inside of the well-guarded tablet. And so thereby what has been inscribed inside of the well-guarded tablet will manifest inside of this world. It is impossible that anything occurs inside of this world, save that it has a prior inscribed existence inside of the well-guarded tablet, and an existence prior to that, pre-eternally inside of the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
مثل الحفر الذي شخص حفر شيئا في الخشب. وهذه الثلاث الأشياء المتسلسلات في القضاء شبهها بعض العلماء تقريبا للأذهان وتصويرا يعني للعقول مثل النجار الذي يحفر شيئا في الخشب.
And here in the scholars يعني رحمه الله تعالى they strike a similitude with the three stages of the decree. Yeah, it's like a carpenter or a joiner who wants to now sort of carve into a piece of wood.
And so
thereby the actual the carpenter give this to a teacher inside of the school. And then thereby the actual teacher now requires for the student to fill it in with color, to color it.
فلا يمكن أن يأتي اللون إلا على حسب المثال الذي حفره ذلك وعلى حسب المعلم الذي أعطاه إياه.
And so it is impossible, يعني, for the actual color to be drawn inside of this piece of wood, except in accordance to this stencil that has been carved out by the actual carpenter.
ولا يمكن أن يحصل شيء في هذا الكون إلا على حسب ما سبق في علم الله ثم على حسب ما كتب في اللوح المحفوظ ويجري على يدينا.
The point being that nothing can exist inside of this lower realm, inside of this world, save that it has an initial existence pre-eternally in the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and thereafter it's been inscribed inside of the well-guarded
tablet.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed everything, literally everything. He's prescribed the faith of the Muslim and the disbelief of the actual disbeliever. He's prescribed, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the obedience of those who obey him and the disobedience of those who disobey him. He's prescribed, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the cure, the healing of the one who was sick, as well as the well-being of the one who was well, the rich of the rich and the poor of the poor. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed and inscribed literally everything. Yeah, and one should be careful of thinking that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's inscription is tantamount to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's command. Because some of them will say, well, how can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punish a disbeliever, when it's him subhanahu wa ta'ala who inscribed it inside of the wall, God the tablet. This is the question they posit. Yani, we say that the inscription relates to knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew what was going to occur, so he inscribed it subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being brief here, Allah ta'ala didn't command them to disbelieve
it.
Maybe you have a point. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded them to disbelieve and then punished them for disbelieving, but that is not the case. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala merely inscribed their disbelief inside of the well guarded tablet.
ثم نقول لذلك الكافر إن أنت خائف من هذا العذاب التي ظن ربنا عز وجل أكرهك عليه تقدر أن تنقد نفسك منه بفعل اختياري الآن قل أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله كان هكلام هذا كله هل أحد ماسك فمك هل أحد ماسك أسنانك قل اتبع أمر الله الله أمرك بالإيمان سبحانه وتعالى.
Note that here now you can sort of end the discussion altogether, yani that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish you inside of the future simply by saying, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, and testify that there's no deity but Allah and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. And now, khalas, the discussion is now complete. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you to believe in him, not to disbelieve in him.
فلا يوجد إكراه من الحق سبحانه وتعالى لعبادة على الكفر. يوجد علم هذا سيكون مؤمن هذا سيكون كافر. علم ولا بد أن يكون علم محيط. كيف سيكون إله ولا يعلم العباد من سيكون مؤمن من سيكون كافر؟ كيف سيكون هذا؟
There is no coercion or compulsion from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as it relates to disbelief. Allah ta'ala does not force you to disbelieve subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he knows that you are going to disbelieve Jalla Jalala wa ta'ala ta'azamatu, and thereby he inscribed it subhanahu wa ta'ala. And note that his knowledge is all-encompassing subhanahu wa ta'ala. How could he be Allah if he did not have all-encompassing knowledge?
هل تعلم أو هل تظن بعقلك أن الله سبحانه وتعالى لا يعلم مقادير عباده كيف سيكون إله وهو لا يعلم تظن بفكرك محدود أن يخلقهم ولا يدري من مسلم من سيموت هذا ليس بإله الإله علم محيط سبحانه وتعالى مكشوف كل شيء له جل جلاله.
Do you think that Allah سبحانه وتعالى's knowledge is deficient and it does not encompass every single deed that a human being will do, those who will be people of faith, those who will live, those who will die? Now, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and his knowledge encompasses everything, and he knows literally everything subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وإذا كان المدرس في الفصل المدرس الذكي يعرف في الفصل في الطلاب من سيفشل في الاختبار ومن سينجح في الاختبار لأنه كل يوم هو يعرف أن هذا ذكي يعرف أن هذا كذا هذا سيأتي بتقدير كذا هذا سيأتي بتقدير كذا إذا كان المعلم يعرف طلابه فكيف لا يعرف الخالق العباد سبحانه وتعالى.
Yani, if a teacher yani knows the nature of his students and he knows which one of his students will pass and he knows which one of his students will fail because he deals and he teaches his students each and every single day. If this is a teacher in relation to students, what about Allah Ta'ala in relation to his creation?
فَإِذَنْ نُؤْمِنْ بِقَضَاءِ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى وَقَدَرِهِ وَنَرَى لَيْسَ نُؤْمِنْ نَرَى بِذَلِكَ نَرَى نَكُنْ رَاضِينَ كما قال نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم فَمَنْ رَضِيَ فَلَهُ الرِّضَى وَمَنْ سَخَطْ فَلَهُ السَّخَطْ.
Yani, and so we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani decree, as well as in the enactment of that decree subhanahu wa ta'ala. And over and above mere belief, we're actually content with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yani decrees, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, that the one who is content will be content with, will receive contentment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the one who is frustrated, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will frustrate them all.
كيف نرضى بالكفر والله سبحانه وتعالى يقول ولا يرضى لعباده الكفر.
Then how could Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love yani disbelief when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself says that Allah is not content with disbelief for his slaves?
كيف نرضى بالظلم ان هذا يقتل هذا وهذا يغتصب هذه وهذا ياخذ مال هذا كيف نرضى بهذا؟
يعني And how can we actually be content with what, with oppression and with tyranny, and this one oppressing another person, this one killing another person, this one yani confiscating yani and stealing the wealth of another? How could we be content with that? No, we said that in both sort of regards we can be content from one perspective but we can abhor it and hate it from another perspective.
وهذا يعني قد يتجرب إلى ذهنك بمثال كما شرح ذلك الإمام الغزالي رحمه الله.
So we can strike an example that would bring it closer to mind, as Imam al-Ghazali رحمه الله تعالى himself elucidated and explained.
فتصور أن ملك من الملوك قال رعيته وقال الذين عنده.
So we think about if like a king. Now he's speaking to his subjects and the ministers who surround him.
قال أنا سأختبر من منكم أيها الرعية يحبني محبة صادقة حقيقية ومن لا يحبني.
So he's saying I'm going to test in which one of you is, يعني is true and faithful in their love for me, and which one is lying that you don't have true love for me.
وسأقيم لكم لذلك ميزان ومعيارا صادقا.
And I'm going to give you a criterion that will prove to be true in this regard.
قال فأن فلان أبو فلان هذا في رعيتي أنا سأسلط عليه من يؤذيه حتى امتحنه حتى يشتمني ويسبني فاذا شتمني وسبني فانا ساغضب عليه واودعه السجن.
He said, such and such a person, I'm going to send people unto him who are going to coerce him, yani through torturing him and the like, to curse me and to abuse me. And then now when he curses me and he abuses me, I'm going to imprison him.
فسلط الملك حينئذ بعض المانع على ذلك الرجل يتكلم عن الملك ويؤذي ذلك الشخص حتى امتلأ قلبه غيظا فسب الملك.
And so likewise, like thereby the king, and he proceeded to send provocateurs unto this man, and thereby, and through coercing the man eventually now begins to curse out the actual king.
فالملك قال لرعيته حينئذ من يحبني لابد أن يبغض هذا ومن لا يحبني يؤيد هذا.
And so thereby the king then addresses his ministers, says, saying that the one who loves me, yani will hate and be angry against this person. But the one who doesn't love me, then they would assist that person in what he's doing, like what he's doing. And so those who were true in their love for the king, they said, no, we hate him, we abhor him.
وكونك أنت الذي تسببت في اختباره وسلطت عليه من يؤذيه حتى يسبك ويشتمك هذا التقدير نحن نرضى به.
Both from the perspective that it's you, O king, is the one who sent provocateurs and then coerced that man into actually cursing you in order to test us, we like that, we're content with the act that you did, O king.
ونرضى بوقوعه عليه.
But, يعني, and we're happy in that it happened to him.
لأنه لو لم يقع عليه لكان مرادك لم يتم ولكان الأمر الذي تبرته لم يحصل وهذا ينقص في كونك ملك حكيم مدبر تنفذ مرادك في رعيتك.
But because had it not occurred as you had wanted, yani he had not cared to, then that would be some type of deficiency upon your part, that you're not able to exact your will as you will inside of your realm.
فنحن نرضى من هذا الوجه.
And so from this perspective, we're happy.
ولكن كونه يشتمك ويسبك نحن لا نرضى بها ونبغضه.
As for from the perspective that he's actually cursing you and abusing you, no, we're not content in that regard, rather we abhor that.
وكان الأولى به أن يصبر وأن يتحمل ولا يتجرع على مقامك فيسبك ويشتمك.
Because what was proper for him was just to be patient and forbearant and not curse you.
فكذلك نحن في القضاء والقدر فيما يحصل في هذا الكون كونه مقدرا من الله نرضى به ولو لم يكن ما كيف إله لا ينفذ مشيئته في عباده أي إله هذا لا ينفذ مشيئته في عباده إذا كان ملك الدنيا لا يرضى أن يكون ملك ولا تنفذ مراده في 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 في, في رعيته فكيف ملك الملوك سبحانه وتعالى.
So this is the same as when we look at events that occur inside of this world that are considered to be evil. That we, from the perspective that it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who ordained that, and it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who enacted that, and that his will exacts itself inside of his creation, we're happy and we're content from that perspective. Yeah, well, if in relation to a king, if we consider a king to be deficient, if he's unable to exact his will inside of his realm, then what about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
ومع أن الملك لا يرضى بشتم ذلك الشخص له فهو يعاقب عليه عاقبه وسجنه على هذا.
And because on the basis that the king is not content with the act the man actually did, in that he abused the king, in that he cursed the king, then it's only proper that the king thereby punishes him and imprisons him.
فكذلك المولى سبحانه وتعالى قدر الإسلام بأسباب خفية عديدة غريبة تعبر تبصر عنها العقول وقدر الكفر بأسباب غريبة عجيبة تقصر عنها العقول لا تدري لماذا سبب كفر هذا وماذا سبب إيمان هذا هل بسبب والده هل بسبب معلمه هل بسبب البيئة وقدر بأسباب غريبة تعجز عقولنا عن إدراك حكمة الله سبحانه وتعالى.
And it's on that basis that we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed very very subtle and slightly any means for a person becoming a Muslim. And likewise also for the disbelief of somebody who disbelieves in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. that escapes the human mind and it's beyond human comprehension as to why a person becomes a Muslim and why a person stays as a disbeliever. But in that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who decreed it, then we're content with it. But then the question is that why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decree? Why is this person a Muslim and that person a disbeliever? Why is this person rich and that person poor? Why is this person and why is this person healthy and that person sick?
فهذا هو السر القدر الذي قال النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يفشى سر القدر في هذه الحياة في هذه المرحلة لا يحتاج العباد أن يعرفوا لماذا هذا ولماذا هذا بعد الموت سيعرفون لماذا كان هذا ولماذا كان هذا الآن في الحياة علينا الأوامر فقط امتثال أوامر الله سبحانه وتعالى واجتناب نواهيه واتباع النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم.
This is the actual secret of the decree. In and of itself, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, that the secret of the decree is not explained, it's not expounded on, it's not told, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So long as we're inside this life, the secret of why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordains that which He ordains is well kept. It will be revealed inside of the world to come upon the day of the day of judgment.
ولذلك علينا الإيمان بهذا الأمر العظيم الإيمان بالقضاء والقدر وفوق الإيمان الرضا.
And so all that upon us is to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to do, we comply. And whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbids us from doing, and thereby we shun. And so inside of this life, all that upon us is to believe in the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But over and above belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree, there also should be contentment. We should be content with everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created.
ضد مراد الإنسان فحينئذ قد يأتي بالاعتراف إما باللسان وإما بالقلب والعياذ بالله.
يعني if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees that which the human being likes, then the human being is ordinarily content. I, whatever Allah ta'ala gives you from blessings subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're content with it so long as it agrees and accords with your desire. But whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees something that contradicts your desire, it's not something that you want, then thereby you lack contentment therein.
وهذا الرضا في حق نفسك أو في حق غيرك حتى إذا ربنا عز وجل أعطى غيرك مالا أو صحة أو أي أمر آخر ترضى بذلك وهذا الرضا حتى في حق غيرك حتى إذا أعطى غيرك شيء ترضى ولا تحسده.
يعني and that this رضا or this contentment is even it's not only it doesn't only relate to yourself but it also relates to others. You should be content whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives or bestows upon somebody else that of wealth or that of health or the like.
لأن بعض الناس في حق نفسه يرضى إذا أعطاه الله مال أو شهرة أو يرضى لكن إذا أعطى غيره لا يرضى بهذا لماذا أعطى هذا لماذا أعطى هذا وهذا من المناقض للقضاء لابد أن ترضى بقضاء الله سبحانه وتعالى الحلو والمر كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خيره وشره من الله تعالى.
Yani some people, they're only content when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows upon other than them, then they display sort of types of discontentment with that. No, yani we should believe in the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether bitter or sweet. And as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, we believe in the decree, both good and evil. Yani look at the actual companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and likewise also the righteous who came after them, and the degree of their contentment and whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed. Yani contentment in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree is derived from or a derivative of having faith in the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First and foremost, it's belief, having faith. Because there are certain groups amongst the Muslims who make errors.
Some
Yani they say that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about love, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala merely means obedience. I.e., to love Allah is tantamount literally to obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there's no meaning any beyond the actual meaning of obedience. But that there is wrong. Yani they made an error there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says he will come with the people and who he loves, and they likewise reciprocal love him.
وبعض المسلمين ظنوا أن الرضا بالقضاء معنى لا ننصح أحد. فإذا رأينا غير مسلم لا ننصحه، وإذا رأينا كذا لا عاصيا لا نرشده. قالوا هذا رضا، خلاص هذا قضاء من الله. كيف نحن نغيره؟ هو خطأ، فهو رضا من وجه وتغيير من وجه.
And so some of them say no contentment in the decree, erroneous. They say the contentment in the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means that we should never advise people, we should never enjoin good upon people and forbid them from doing wrong. Because it's the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that whatever manifests upon their limbs, and so it's unalterable. No, yani we are content from a perspective, but we advise, we attempt to change from another perspective.
انظروا كيف رضا الأنبياء والصحابة والتابعين بقضاء الله وقدره المر على بواطنهم يرضون بهذا.
Yani look at the decree of the contentment that we see that manifests in the hearts of the prophets, the hearts of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the hearts of those who follow them in perfection and in excellence, and how the degree of their contentment in the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, although it was something bitter upon their heart, and the event that was now decreed for them.
هذا سيدنا عروة بن الزبير رضي الله عنه مات له ولد صغير طلع فوق السطح فسقط ومات ثم جاءه مرض فقطعت قدمه فصار بقدم فلما جاء الناس يعني يرفعونه في هذه المصيبة فقال الحمد لله كان لي ولدان أخذ واحد وترك الآخر ولو شاء أخذ الاثنين معه وكانت لي قدمة أخذ أخرى واحدة وابقى لي الأخرى ولو شاء أخذ الاثنين معه فأنا راضي بقضاء الله عز وجل.
Look at the example of Sayyidina Urwa ibn Zubayr radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. He had a son who died. His son, it fell off a roof and thereby he died. And likewise also he had one of his legs amputated. And so when people came unto Sayyidina Urwa ibn Zubayr radiallahu ta'ala anhuma and was saying, you were trying to sort of console him as to what occurred. He says, no, I'm content. I have two sons. Allah took one and Allah ta'ala left one with me. I have two legs. Allah ta'ala took one and Allah ta'ala left one with me. I'm content with the decree of Allah Ta'ala.
وكان سيدنا عبد الله بن عمر بن الخطاب عنده ولد يحبه ولد صغير يحبه ويشفق عليه والناس يعرفون شدة محبته له فمات ذلك الولد الصغير فخافوا على الشيخ كيف هذا الآن ولده مات وهو طفل صغير فلما خرج في الجنازة رؤي متبسما فرحانا كأن لم يحصل شيء.
And so another example is سيدنا عبد الله بن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله تعالى عنه وارضاه. Yani he had a young son who he loved dearly, but that son thereafter died. And so thereby people were saying, well, how is the Shaykh, yani Sayyidina Abdullah radiallahu anhu warda, going to be in such a circumstance? And so when they attended the actual funeral of what the son of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu warda, they saw Sayyidina Abdullah in attending the funeral in a very, very happy in way, countenance. He was smiling radiallahu anhu.
فقالوا لسيدنا عبد الله بن عمر أين ذلك؟ أين الحزن؟ وأين خوف على هذا الولد فقال لما كان حيا كان تحتنا فلما مات أسلمته إلى الله ورضيت بقضاء الله.
And so Sayyidina Abdullah, the same to Abdullah bin Umar, look, you're smiling, like you're happy. And shouldn't you be crying? And shouldn't you be sad? And Sayyidina Abdullah bin Umar, he says, whilst my son was alive, he was sort of beneath my hand. And I'm the one looking after him. Now he's died, I placed him in the hand and the care of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'm content with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وكان سيدنا الفضيل بن العياض رضي الله عنه عنده ولد وكان سيدنا الفضيل هذا يغلب عليه الجلال ويغلب عليه الهيبة وقل أن يتبسم مشغولا بأمور علوية دائما في الهيبة ودائما في الجلال وفي القبر. سيدنا الفضيل بن العياض.
سيدنا الفضيل بن العياض رضي الله تعالى عنه وارضاه. يعني he had a child. And Sayyidina Fudayl radiallahu anhu warda, he was known as somebody who was overcome by majesty. He was very, very majestic. He was somebody awe-inspiring. Yeah, he inspired awe inside of the hearts of people, Sayyidina Fudayl radiallahu anhu warda. He hardly ever smiled, radiallahu anhu warda. He was always concerned with the higher affairs, the affairs of the celestial and the spiritual realm.
فمات له ولد شباب فلما خرج في جنازته إذا به متبسم مستبشر على غير عادته.
Likewise, also his son died. And now when he attends the funeral, Sayyidina Fudayl radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala, you see that Sayyidina Fudayl is happy and he's smiling, and that contradicted his normal mannerism. And people said the same, and Fudayl, everybody was amazed by this. Yani, why are you sort of happy and why are you smiling? And shouldn't you be sad at this moment? And he said that the actual sweetness of contentment has sort of overcome the bitterness of this tribulation.
And so عندما نرضى بقضاء الله وهو فرع كما قلنا عن الإيمان الأمور كلها قد كتبت ما يتحرك شيء إلا وقد كتب في اللوح المحفوظ.
And so contentment, it has a sweetness inside of the heart, and as we said, يعني contentment is derived يعني from faith. And nothing occurs save that it's already been inscribed and decreed inside of the world garden tablet. And so when you have contentment in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, accordingly, you move away from any type of stress and distress. And one of the poets, he said, Ilzam bab rabbak, and he says, yani, cling to the door of your Lord. And abandon everything other than him. And ask your Lord for security or safety from the abode of tribulation. Don't allow your heart to become constricted. And because anything that occurs is simple.
Allah al-Muqaddir والعالم شؤون لا يقصر همك ما قدر يكون.
Allah is the one who decrees and the world is just affairs. يعني. Do not allow your همك. Do not allow your distress or your distress to get out of control. Whatever has been decreed will come to pass.
انظروا لما حصل هذا فيروس كورونا بعض الصدور ضاقت لكن المراضين بالقضاء الله يعلمون أن هذا من الله سبحانه وتعالى فيروس يتحرك بمراد الله وبقدرة الله ليس بذاته وله أمد محدود رضاء بقضاء الله من الله وإلى الله سبحانه وتعالى.
Look what happened during the coronavirus يعني period. يعني those and the nature of human beings' hearts at that point in time. But those who were content, yani with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, were content with what was occurred, knowing that this was basically only by the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they did not occur, quote unquote, of its own accord or in and of its own self by its own devices, but solely by Allah Ta'ala's decree.
فإذا حصلت مثل هذه الحوادث أدبوك أنت أيها المؤمن مع المولى سبحانه وتعالى ترك الهم والاختيار همك واهتمامك دعهما وراك الهم والاهتمام وراك والتدبير أيضا لا تدبر اطمئن تحت الرضا والقضاء واسكن تحت القضاء والقدر والتدبير أيضا واشهد من براك غمض اهتمامك.
And so you must have proper etiquette يعني with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whenever anything occurs inside of this lower realm. And from the proper etiquette is to be content with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees, and you should not show an iota of discontentment or distress يعني due to things that occur, quote unquote, inside of our everyday lives.
نعم من علامات الاعتراض وهذا شيء خطير والعياذ بالله الاعتراض على المولى في مجريات القضاء والقدر إما أن يكون باللسان وإما أن يكون بالقلب.
Yani discontentment in whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees, yani is extremely dangerous, regardless of whether it's discontentment upon the tongue or discontentment within the heart. Yani to articulate words that are tantamount to discontentment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We take refuge in Allah
ta'ala. قولد الحمق لو حصل كذا وكذا لما كان كذا لو عملت كذا وكذا لما كان كذا وكذا هذا قول الأحمق الذي ينفر من مراد الإلهي الذي سينفذ فيه رغم عنه
يعني لو يعني if only this had happened يعني لم it shouldn't have happened كيف how did it happen the poet he says لو ولم وكيف they're the statements of somebody who's absolutely stupid يعني
وكيف قول ذي الحمق يعترض على الله الذي خلق
يعني they are showing discontentment يعني against God the one who creates
وقضى وقدر كل شيء بحق
يعني he decreed and ordained everything in truth
فكل شيء مقدر بحكمة وتدبير عظيمين فوق اقتراح عقولنا البشرية.
Everything that Allah سبحانه وتعالى decrees has been ordained with the underpinning wisdom that is beyond human comprehension.
فلما يقول لو كان كذا أو لو كان كذا وكذا كأنه يعترض على هذا التدبير، والأولى له أن يطلب الله أن يكشف له الحكمة من هذا التدبير، وليس يعترض لا اكشف لي الحكمة كما انكشفت للأنبياء والأصفياء فيعلمون حكمة الله من خلق الشرور، من خلق الكفر، من خلق الامتحانات، يعلمون حكمته فيسكنون تحت القضاء والقدر.
And so forth. Somebody say, if only this had happened, if only this had happened, when something occurs inside of their life, that date is not proper. What is better is to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reveal or to unveil for you the underpinning wisdom as to something happened, as to why something happened, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed and unveiled for the prophets themselves. The underpinning wisdom is why things happen inside of creation, so that their hearts fall into a state of contentment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and serenity.
ولذلك بعض المسلمين عندما يدعو ربه سبحانه وتعالى في مطلب من المطالب ولا يتحدد يصيب ذلك المسلم الجزع والضجر والهلق والقلق، لماذا لم يحصل هذا؟ لماذا لم يكن كذا وكذا؟
That's why you see some Muslims whenever they ask something of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that which they ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not manifest, quote unquote, in the way that they desire for it to manifest. Thereby you see they become discontented, contented. Some that thereby you see they become stressed or they become frustrated. No, it should be the opposite of that.
ولكن الأنبياء والأصفياء إذا دعوا ربهم سبحانه وتعالى ولم يعطهم شيء كشف لهم سبحانه وتعالى عن الحكمة في تأخير هذا الدعاء، الحكمة في تأخير هذا كشف البلاء، فإذا كشف عن قلوبهم يطمئنون الأنبياء تحت القضاء والقدر، لا يقول أبدا يعرفون الحكمة في تأخير هذا الأمر وفي عدم تحقيقه من الله سبحانه وتعالى لهم.
That's why you see with the prophets themselves, whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordains or decrees something for the prophets themselves, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thereafter removed the veil and revealed to them the wisdom as to why this thing that is seemingly bitter manifests inside of the actual heart, manifests inside the lives of the prophets. I.e., when they ask something of Allah ta'ala in du'a and Allah ta'ala delays it, or they ask for Allah ta'ala to remove some type of tribulation and Allah ta'ala removes, delays the removal of that tribulation, Allah ta'ala thereby unveils the underpinning wisdom as to why, and then thereby you see the prophets themselves beneath the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in states of contentment and in states of serenity.
وهذا الرضا بالقضاء والقدر يورثك أيها المؤمن ذوق حلاوة الإيمان وطعم الإيمان.
So now this, contentment in the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it bequeathed unto you, O Muslim, the sweetness of faith.
الإيمان هذا له حلاوة روحية معنوية.
Faith has a metaphysical and a spiritual sweetness. When you taste this sweetness, then it becomes easy for you to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and display impeccable character towards others. So you have to stir the sweetness of this faith that exists inside of your heart and soul.
ونحن دائما نقول أن الإيمان هذا في قلوب الناس مثل الشاهي وسط القوم ووسطه السكر، فإذا حركت السكر تذوقت حلاوة الشاهي، إذا لم تحرك السكر لا تتذوق حلاوة الشاهي، تراه مر لا تريد أن تتناول منه، إذا حركت الإيمان في قلبك تذوقت حلاوة الدين العظيم.
And so we often let me strike the example of the sweetness of faith that is deposited inside of your heart like a cup of tea. And inside of that tea, you place some sugar. And if you stir the cup of tea, you taste the sweetness. But if you don't stir the cup of tea and you taste the tea, it's bitter. Likewise, also faith. Allah Ta'ala has deposited a sweetness inside of your faith, but you must stir that faith in order to taste its sweetness. Now when you taste the sweetness of faith, it doesn't become strange to you as to why the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would stand the entire night in prayer.
لا تستغرب كيف قرأ هذا التابعي الجليل 30,000 ختمة.
And it's not going to be strange to you, why did the tabi'i, the student of the companion, there, finish the Quran 30,000 times? Because every time he completed the Quran, he tasted the sweetness of faith.
هذا شعبة بن الحجاج ابن الورد العتكي شيخ إمام الشافعي في الحديث. لولا شعبة لذهب علم الحديث قال ابن الشافعي. شعبة بن الحجاج بن الورد العتكي من أكابر شيوخ الحديث.
شعبة ابن
الحجاج
ابن الحجاج Ibn al-Gurd al-Ataqi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the great tabi'i, who is a sheikh of Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa ardahu, in hadith, to the point that Imam al-Shafi'i said about him, if it wasn't for Shu'bah, then all of the knowledge of hadith of the prophetic traditions would have disappeared. And look at the sweetness of faith that was inside of his heart, upon which the basis that you saw the amount, the profundity of good deeds and of righteous deeds and obedience act that he did.
And
when Sayyidina Shu'bah was on his deathbed and he was in and out of consciousness, yani his daughter entered in upon him. And so his daughter now begins to cry and she becomes saddened by the fact that her father is now upon his last, the pangs of death now are overtaking him and he's in and out of consciousness. And so thereby he opens up his eyes and he looks at his daughter who is crying and he says, why are you crying, oh my daughter? And she says, why should I cry, oh my father, that you're about to die now, you're about to leave us? He said, no, my daughter, don't cry over me. Rather, you should be happy for me.
He
says, look at the corner of the room. So she looks at the corner of the room.
He
said, your father has read 30,000 completions of the Quran inside of that corner. You don't cry over your father.
فانظر كيف حلاوة الإيمان بالرضا والقضاء والقدر تدفعهم من هذه الحقائق الكبيرة.
Look at the sweetness of faith with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the enactment that it has sort of repelled the bitterness of what is occurring right now.
الرضا من أسرع الطرق لأن تتذوق هذه الحقيقة في قلبك حلاوة الإيمان وأن تفعلها.
And the contentment in the decree of Allah ta'ala is the swiftest and the quickest way that you can taste the sweetness of faith.
هذا جاء في صحيح مسلم عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال من رضي بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا
because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam inside the tradition, inside of Sahih Muslim, that he says, whoever is content with Allah as a Lord and Islam as a religion and with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a prophet, then they have tasted the sweetness of faith.
عندنا الشافعية يعني ذوق الطعام في نهار رمضان مكروه فقط ويكره العلك وذوق الاحتلال يكره العلك وذوق الاحتلال هذا الذوق لأنه لا يوجد شيء حقيقي فقط يطعم هذا الطعام هذا مالها وغير ذلك.
يعني ذوق here يعني to taste it's something that occurs upon the actual يعني tip of the tongue in and of itself. And Habib just mentioned inside of the school of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, inside of Ramadan, I during the fasting, whilst one is fasting, it is dislike for one to taste food, just with the tip of the tongue.
فإذن بداية حقائق الإيمان الذوق تذوق طعم الشيء بطرف اللسان أنت ستتذوق حلاوة إذن للإيمان طعم وستبدأ تتذوق حلاوته.
And so Habib differentiate between tasting something and tasting the sweetness of something. And so now when you begin to stir your faith, you're not only in the beginning, you're just tasting it, but then you begin to taste the sweetness of it. And the meaning of that we're content with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that we're content with his ordainment and with his acts inside of his creation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we also be content with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahibu sallam, who's the most perfect of all messengers and the seal of the messengers.
ديننا الإسلامي جمع محاسن الأديان كلها وأبسط الأديان وأيسر الأديان.
The religion of Islam, it's gathered all of the beauty of all of the previous religions, and also it's been simplified and facilitated.
ليس فيه أي شدة ولا أي صعوبة.
Like there's no extremity or difficulty therein.
خيارات مفتوحة أمامك في كل عبادة.
يعني you have multiple choices or ways of approaching any single act of worship.
لم تقدر تتوضأ تتيمم.
And if you're not able to make ablution, then make tayammum.
لم تقدر تصلي دائما صل جالس. لم تقدر تصلي في البيت في المسجد صل في البيت.
If you can't pray in the mosque, then pray in the house.
لم تقدر تصلي في البيت صل في السيارة.
If you can't pray in the house, then you can pray in your car or smoothly.
في كل العبادات خيارات على حسب قوة الإيمان وضعف الإيمان.
يعني we have multiple choices as it relates to acts of worship in accordance to the strength and weakness of faith.
في الصلاة، في الصيام، في الحج، في أوقات الحج، مذاهب أربعة كلها موصلة إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى.
And in prayer, in fasting, in Hajj, the pilgrimage, all of the four schools of jurisprudence facilitate arrival at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
المهم أن تقوم بالعبادة.
What is important, you worship.
أما أن لا يصلي أبدا هذا الخطر، صل في البيت، صل في المسجد، صل في محل العمل.
You know, as for you not to pray, that day is a problem. Can you pray inside of your house, pray inside of work, pray inside of the mosque?
صلوا أنت مريض, صلوا أنت في المستشفى, صلوا أنت في الدم, صل قابل ربك سبحانه وتعالى.
Can you pray when you're sick? Can you pray when you're in the hospital? Pray, blood's flowing from you. It's important, pray.
انظر عمل يسير يعطينا الله مقابله شيء كبير.
And look for something simple in terms of work. Allah Ta'ala recompenses you in a great way, in a big way.
وكيف نحصل على هذا الرضا؟
And how then can we sort of attain
contentment? محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم قال له كرر هذه الألفاظ رضيت بالله ربا وبالإسلام دين محمد النبي رسول رضيت بالله ربا أنت كررها فقط ثلاثة من الصباح وثلاثة من المساء باطنك سيشعر بأنوار الرضا عن الله ومن الله
The prophet started to allude to the fact that you should say that statement رضيت بالله ربا وبالإسلام دين وبي سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيا ورسوله You should repeat that over and over again Three times in the morning, three times in the evening. Then you begin to taste the sweetness of faith. Because our Lord is generous. Even when we say it with our tongue, without it really being affirmed inside of our heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows His mercy upon us, and then He bestows upon us.
قال صلى الله عليه وسلم من قال رضيت بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيا ورسولا كان حقا على الله أن يرضيه يوم القيامة.
That's why the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. That's why the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he said that whoever he says يعني I am content with Allah as a Lord and with Islam as a religion and with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم as a message then it's only right that Allah subhanahu wa taala makes him content. On the day of judgment.
واحد الصالحين رأى في منامه رؤيا صالحة. عندنا في البخاري الرؤيا الصالحة والرؤيا الحسنة. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم الرؤيا الصالحة خير من جزء من الرؤيا الصالحة جزء من 26 جزء من النبوة.
يعني one of the righteous he saw a good dream. يعني we have in terms of the religion. يعني we in Sahih Bukhari we have like good dreams. We have true dreams. We have beautiful dreams. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. The tradition that a good dream is 1/46 of prophecy. In another version, the Prophet said it's
1/70th.
So Habib says, if you want to have a good dream, you want to try it out, then make wudu before you go to sleep, then pray two rak'ah upon that wudu, and then go to sleep. Tell us what you see.
ولكن هاتان الركعتان لابد أن لا تحدث نفسك فيهما بشيء حضور مع الله سبحانه وتعالى. Yeah. وانظر ماذا ترى.
Or remember these two rak'ah, you must be completely with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, present with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't have any type of quote unquote any erroneous thought in.
تقدر أن تجرب من هذه الليلة المباركة ليلة الاثنين.
So try it tonight. Tonight's the Monday night, yeah. Sunday night, Monday night in Islam.
انظر ماذا ترى وأين روحك ترى.
So see what you're going to see now. See where your soul goes.
هذا الرجل الصالح رأى في منامه هذه الرؤيا الصالحة المبشرة.
So this righteous man, he had a good dream that brought glad tidings.
فرأى في منامه كأن عبدا من المقصرين على أنفسهم حضرته الملائكة أمام الله سبحانه وتعالى.
So it was as if there was a person يعني, who was deficient as it relates to the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was dragged in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the angels.
والمولى سبحانه وتعالى يسأل ذلك الإنسان لما فعلت كذا لما فعلت كذا.
And the Lord is asking this man, why did you do this and why did you do that?
فقال يا رب فعلت هذا حسن ظن مني بك.
And the man said, Oh my Lord, I did it out of the good opinion that I have of you.
واعتمادا على كرمك وعفوك.
And I was reliant upon your generosity and upon your forgiveness.
فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى يا ملائكتي اشهدكم انه عندما قال هذا كاذب واني لم اخطر على باله قط.
يعني and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then addressed the angels. He said, Oh angels, I make you testify that he's a liar. That when he did such acts, I never occurred to his mind, not even once.
ولكنه إذ قد ادعى هذا اعتمادا على جودي وكرمي فقد غفرت له. كونه ادعى هذا فقط.
For so long as he's making the claim that he was thinking of me, then I forgive him.
فانظر نحن عندما نكرر رضينا بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا ومحمد النبي ورسوله حتى وإن كنا في باطننا غير صادقين إن شاء الله بكرم الله نكون صادقين ويقبل هذا منا ربنا عز وجل.
So long as we say, يعني I am pretty content with Allah as a Lord and with Islam as a religion and with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم as a messenger, then even if we're not truthful in that regard, يعني inshallah, we have good hope with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we'll forgive him. Ameen. So we ask that Allah ta'ala gathers us with the people of contentment and with those righteous believers, those who are secured, those who have been given glad tidings, and those who are ecstatic and joyous and happy.
الذين لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون.
Those upon whom there is no fear, nor shall they ever grieve.
ويجعلنا وياكم أسبابا للهدايات.
May Allah Ta'ala make all of us that are the means to guidance.
وأسبابا للسعادات.
And the means to happiness.
وأسبابا للترقيات.
And likewise the means to ascension.
ويجمعنا مع نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم.
May He gather us with our Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
في الدار الآخرة.
Inside of the world to come.
من غير سؤال ولا حساب.
Without any reckoning or without any account.
وجمعنا في هذا المسجد وفي هذه الليلة المباركة يجمعنا على حوض النبي محمد.
And in the same way that Allah Ta'ala gathered us inside of this blessed mosque, may Allah Ta'ala gather us at the hold, the life pool of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And likewise our elders and our teachers and our beloveds from amongst the Muslims.
Beside the Sheikh, we thank the Sheikh for his time, mashallah. And alhamdulillah. As the Khalifa of the Prophet has indicated that the people of Yemen, they are known for their musafaha, that they are known for their handshakes. If you can please make a line and we can shake the hand of the Sheikh, inshallah, and the adhan will sound in a few minutes, inshallah.
Yes or no? Yes
or no? Okay, if we can make a line from Mustafa, please do come forward, inshallah. Please shake the hand quickly and move on, inshallah. Let's not crowd the area. And the Azam will sound for Isha Salah.
No, leave this one here. Okay. Sorry.
I did.